involve altered gene expression. If you were familiar with signal transduction through the PAM receptor, isn't this just signal transduction through a different receptor, in this case the cytokine receptor? Okay? So I don't see any reason really to go through all this. It's just another row of dominoes. Okay? You guys, did anybody miss any points today on the quiz? So you guys already went through it. Okay? So that's good, because technically I didn't get to this slide for you guys. But the concepts, we covered signal transduction concepts, receptor binding concept, gene activation concepts. It's just another story of signal transduction, a cellular response to something that's happening at their surface. In this case, binding to cytokine. So that's sort of a big idea. Okay. So the last slide was, okay. Again, let's put it all together. All together now, right? So this is the overview, basically, of that whole lecture packet. Okay. We have cells of the innate immune system. Let's call this a macrophage, but it could be a dendritic cell. The sentinel cells, well armed with PAM receptors to recognize invasion. Okay, they're going to be in our tissues, under our skin, they're at mucosal surfaces, because that's where microbes come in. There you see it interacting with the bacteria. You can't see the PAM. You can't see the PAM receptor, but you know they're there, because look how the cell responded. And you know why it responded, because of signal transduction cascades and turning on the gene. In response to microbe interaction, here we're releasing five different cytokines, okay? IL-1 beta, tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin-6, this is a chemokine, interleukin-12. Down here is telling you, what are the biological effects? You know, why did this macrophage release all these things? Who's he trying to talk to? Well, you know, he's trying to talk to the blood vessel wall, vascular endothelial cells. He's trying to upregulate temperature, so he's interacting with fat and muscle cells. He wants to recruit neutrophils, okay? He wants to activate NK cells, blah, 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 okay? He says, I don't want to fight off these bacteria by myself. I need some help. I need to induce inflammation. And here it is all visually. Healthy, microbe comes in. Here's the cytokines. Here's the cellular changes, the tissues changes, and inflammation, you know? We're going to resolve that infection. But that macrophage is going to do it all by itself. He's just sort of orchestrating the response. Is that basically, that was kind of fast, but is that basically what you're seeing in the picture? And does that basically capture what we tried to achieve in this lecture packet for you? Okay. And you don't have to nod your head. You can raise your hand and say, Dr. Ivan, that made no sense whatsoever. You have to try again, which I will do. Okay, but I think that's basically what we did. Okay? Okay. Let's try a new topic here. Okay. Cells, tissues, and organs. We need to know where in the body all these events are happening, particularly when we're talking about lymphoid tissues. We're now starting our discussion sort of adaptive immunity, okay? This is sort of the first sort of step in the direction of, okay, let's leave complement defenses, macrophages, let's leave those. Now let's start talking about adaptive immunity, okay? For the rest of the semester, we're going to be in a lymph node, in the spleen, in the Peyer's patches, talking about B cells, T cells, dendritic cells doing antigen presentations. We have to start that discussion, but we need to know where in the body these things are happening. Okay? So here's the body. Okay? So we're going to look at cells of the immune system, tissues, and organs of the immune system. And they're all shown in that picture, but let's just move ahead and one by one go through these things. Okay. We need to first start with this process called hematopoiesis. How many of you ever heard that term before? Hematopoiesis, okay? Which means development of all of our blood cells, all of our white blood cells, all our red blood cells, lymphocytes, neutrophils, dendritic cells, macrophages, mast cells, anything that is a cell that plays a role in the immune system, all comes from the exact same cell, which is the hematopoietic stem cell. And what these blue arrows are showing you are just different developmental pathways that bone marrow hematopoietic stem cell can take to differentiate into a B cell, into a T cell, into a macrophage, into a dendritic cell, so on and so forth for all of our red blood cells. And this, of course, is why it's catastrophic if your bone marrow stops functioning, okay? Because now you cannot produce any more blood cells, red or white, okay? And of course, that is lethal, okay? It might require bone marrow transplant to sort of, you know, reestablish all of this, okay? So, the process is called hematopoiesis, and where it takes place in your body really depends on where you are in your own development as an organism. When you're a few weeks old in the womb, okay, this job is done by the yolk sac. The yolk sac is generating the red blood cells of the developing body, okay? Eventually, you get to the point where you're actually developing organs. You're gonna have a fetus and a liver, okay? The yolk sac, of course, goes away, disappears, and now hematopoiesis is taken over by the fetal liver and the fetal spleen,
before you're born and after you're born for the rest of your life, this is exclusively a bone marrow process. All of this is happening in your bone marrow. Okay? So, here's a hematopoietic stem. So there's sort of three, if you're a hematopoietic stem cell, your first decision is I go down three paths. I go left, I go forward, I go right. If I go right, that's the lymphoid lineage. I'm gonna go in this direction, you're gonna become one of three cells. A T lymphocyte, a B lymphocyte, or an NK cell. Those are the three lymphocytes of the body. That, you know, once you sort of make that decision of stepping right, those are your only three fates. You're still pluripotent, means you still have multiple options of what you can develop into. But once you get to this point, you can't become any of those other cells. At least not naturally. Some researchers can throw some cytokines and try to steer things the other way. That's not how it's going to happen in your body. Okay? You step to the left. That's the myeloid lineage. Okay? All these other white blood cells you have potentially become. Okay? But again, once you get to these crossroads, options start changing. Okay? So when you get here and you go, oh, I'm going to go over here, that's your only fate. You can't become these other things. And the third, I guess if you step forward, that's the erythroid lineage. It means you're either going to become a red blood cell or a platelet, okay? And that's shown over here, okay? Lymphoid lineage, myeloid lineage, erythroid lineage, okay? What do you think differentiates a hematopoietic stem cell says, I'm going to go in this direction, versus a hematopoietic stem cell says, I'm going to go in that direction? What are the inputs? How do I know where to go? What's telling me to go where? To develop into this or develop into that? Cytokines, absolutely. That is how I want you to fundamentally think about two ways cells communicate with each other. Remember, there's a lot of cells in the bone marrow, and they're all bumping up next to each other and they're releasing cytokines. Absolutely. And certain cytokines direct cells down these different developmental paths. What's another input? Because remember, a cytokine is a diffusible product. They sort of floating around in their environment, they grab onto it, respond to it. What would be another way that one cell could tell another cell, hey, I'm providing some information to you, you know, go down this way? What is another way cells can communicate with each other apart from diffusible products like cytokines? Yes? Well, that would still be a diffusible thing, right? That's still one cell produces it. Okay, yeah, but you're right. You're right. But the mechanism is still the same.
Direct binding?
Absolutely. Two cells. Well, I mean, think of how densely packed cells are in all your tissues, okay? And that means this cell can have, you're going to hopefully learn a lot about the cell biology, I hope, if Dr. Barron is doing what he's supposed to be doing, okay? You know, a ligand on this cell, a receptor on this cell, what do you think happens when a receptor binds a ligand? To which cell?
The
one with the receptor, absolutely. So cells can communicate that way. And again, each of these cells is getting different inputs. I'm getting pushed to become a lymphocyte. Well, I'm getting pushed to become a megakaryocyte to become a red blood cell. Okay? But again, different cells occupy a big theme that you're going to hear me talk about a lot of this class is microenvironment. The microenvironment for a cell is their unique place in the body universe. Think of each of you as a cell right now. Think of you as a cell. Where, you know, I don't care if you're in a lymph node, where. Isn't each of your microenvironment unique? The people you're sitting next to, okay, whether they're jabbing at the elbow or they're not, okay? Or one's being noisy, one's not being noisy. I mean, that's what I mean by microenvironment. You guys are all in a unique little environment, okay? Different inputs. You know, I probably can't hear what Holly's saying, but, you know, now good. It's a silly analogy, but that's how you have to think about it, okay? And that's why one cell, I'm going this way, and this cell, I'm going this way, okay? So that idea of a microenvironment, okay, is a big idea for a lot of the principles I want to teach in this class, how the new system functions. Okay, so let's introduce the cells real quick. Okay? And on the right-hand side there, I'm just putting that so you can sort of write in whatever little notes you want, okay? I don't really care necessarily that you can identify them by sight, but I generally want to introduce these cells in these terms so I can use these terms the rest of the class, the rest of the semester, and you guys know what we're talking about. Okay, erythrocytes, those are red blood cells. Everybody knows that, RBCs, okay? Leukocytes. Is leukocyte a specific cell type or a general cell type? I'm sorry, I heard specific and I thought I heard general. Okay, maybe the question wasn't very good. I would say it's very general. It basically just means white blood cell. There is no cell. You can't say, oh, there's the leukocyte. You can say, there's a leukocyte, there's a leukocyte, there's a leukocyte, there's a leukocyte. So any cell that's not a red blood cell, that's a white blood cell, is a leukocyte. That's leukocyte. So I'd say that's sort of a general term. There's a lot of different types of leukocytes. That's just a white blood cell. you do a blood separation, you take a blood spin, okay, and you separate the red blood cells from the lipid component, which is the plasma, all the leukocytes, sometimes called a Buffy coat, okay, that whole collective we call the Buffy coat, there they are. There's the B cells, the T cells, the monocytes, the dendritic cells, if they happen to be migrating through the blood, basophils, these, and all those are the leukocytes. So I would say it's a very general term, okay? Lymphocytes, lymphocytes is kind of a general term, but now we know there's only three cells we're talking about. What are the three lymphocytes? B cells, T cells, NK, yeah, go back to this picture right here, NK cells, okay? Now, I will explain to you what a plasma cell is, and I'll explain to you what affects your T cells, but that's still a B cell, that's still a T cell. We there's just some differentiation here that we have to talk about, okay? Okay. What is a granulocyte? Name a granulocyte.
Neutrophil.
Okay, so to decide which cells are the granulocytes, you have to say which ones have granules in their cytoplasm. Little membrane-bound granules, a lot of nasty stuff inside of them, okay? And with using the proper cell stains, you can see them. Okay, so see the cytoplasm of this, all those little purple dots, those are granules, okay? Here in the cartoon. So basophil is a granulocyte. Eosinophil definitely is a granulocyte. Neutrophil is a granulocyte, okay? Now the mast cell up here, I have to admit, I don't think they actually, I mean, they're highly granularized, but when you hear the term granulocyte, they usually don't include the mast cells. Mast cells, for the most part, are tissue-borne. They're tissues, they're not circulating in your blood. But they are highly granularized. We'll talk a lot about granular release by mast cells later this semester. Okay? Polymorphonuclear leukocytes. What does polymorphonuclear mean? Just by setting the term. Poly, what does poly mean? Many. Morpho.
Change.
Nuclear. Nuclear. Okay? So basically the granulocytes are also the polymorphonuclear. Right. Okay? Look at these crazy looking nuclei. Big lobes, and, okay? Versus like what you find in an NK cell or a, you know, a plasma cell or a lymphocyte. I mean, you know, generally round, okay? Look at the lymphocytes up there, okay? That'd be like a B cell or a naive B cell, which is almost entirely nucleus, like a little bit of cytoplasm has, okay? Phagocytes, basically a phagocyte is just a cell that has that ability to, has phagocytic receptors, and will phagocytose, you know, a bacteria or something like that. The two real major phagocytes are the what? Macrophages and the whenever we talk about phagocytosis, that's what we'll be talking about. Okay, then the last term is antigen-presenting cells. Haven't really talked about what antigen presentation is yet, but you're going to know that up back sideways by the semester, okay, starting very shortly. The best APC, which is that you'll hear that term, or sometimes you heard about professional APC, okay, is the dendritic cell. So there's two other cells that can do antigen presentation of T cells. Has anybody read ahead and know what those other two cell types are? Macrophage can do it, yeah. So dendritic cell, macrophage, what is the third one? It can present antigen to T cells. Excellent, B cells, B lymphocytes. Okay. And so I'm just introducing that idea. We're going to talk ad nauseum about that process. Okay, here's the first quiz. Discuss this amongst yourself. What if you've still not logged in? I would say to answer this question, focus on primarily on the last thing I said here in parentheses. That sort of big idea you need to capture your answer. So someone having phone problems again? Let's see what person has a problem again.
It's just me. It's taking like a second. I'm always.
It's there. Okay, you're in. Okay. Saying hematopoietic stem cells, that is
lot of cells in your body that are dividing, these drugs don't do a very good job of discriminating. So, you know, might go bald, right, because your hair follicles are dividing cells, they die, okay? You might become sterilized because your, you know, your gametes and your sperm and eggs, you know, are dividing cells, okay? So that's a problem. But your bone marrow is an site of massive, hematopoiesis is basically a massive cell proliferation all every day of your life, okay? So third option, destroy your bone marrow, okay? So in treating the cancer, very often you, well, that's great, you don't have cancer, but now you don't have any bone marrow, and you're going to die because from anemia and your immune system is destroyed, okay? So typically they do what? After treating leukemia, if they have to do that aggressively, what is the next step in the sort of healing process? Bone marrow transplant. Well, later in the semester, you're going to learn all the problems there are with transplants with respect to mismatched MHC, transplant rejection. In the case of bone marrow transplants, it's an issue called graft versus host disease, life-threatening, very horrible. So anyway, so the doctors knew that this was going to happen to my friend. And so a modern way of dealing with this is, okay, before we actually blast your cancer, we're going to go into your body and we're going to get some of your hematopoietic stem cells, okay? In fact, we're not even going to go to your bone marrow. What we're going to do is we're going to give you a drug that's going to make your bone marrow start churning out massive amounts of hematopoietic stem cells, so many that they're going to start leaving the bone marrow and entering your blood. What do you think the foundation of that drug is? A drug that is going to make hematopoietic stem cells start dividing, dividing, dividing. Okay, so but this isn't a drug to cure the cancer. This is all prior to drug cancer treatment. This is, we want to, because we want to go to your body, we want to get your own hematopoietic stem cells that we're going to put back to you in the 2 months after we blow your bone marrow away. We're going to give your own cells back, and we get to get those cells. So we're going to give you a drug that makes your bone marrow supercharge, start to produce hematopoietic stem cells, literally so many that they start leaving the bone marrow and getting into your blood. It's very easy to collect blood and harvest those cells. What do you think? Anybody want to take a guess at what that drug might be? I mean, what did we just talk about what influences hematopoiesis? Cytokine. There is a very specific human cytokine that, okay, what it's called, granulocyte colony stimulating factor, something like that, the GM-CSF, that makes these guys just go divide, not differentiate into something, but they actually do that too. Okay, that was a direct contradiction, but they do. But again, you start supercharging hematopoietic stem cell development or division. They go into your bloodstream for a couple weeks or months. They just kept taking his blood. There's something called cell sorting. You selectively say, I only want those cells, and all the other cells are probably just infused right back into him. And then they took those cells, they put them in the freezer. They're going to be needed another day. Then they went and dealt with the leukemia, and yes, they destroyed his bone marrow in the process. But now it's not really a bone marrow transfer from someone else that's going to have graft rejection issues. These are your bone marrow. If they're you, your body's going to accept these, and let's put them back into you. So there's a lot to be learned there. Just the rationale. Why would you use a cytokine? Why the hematopoietic stem cell? Because the hematopoietic stem cells, they just put them intravenous. And they'll find their way to the bone marrow. They'll just set up shop. Okay, where were we now? Okay, let's start making all the blood cells the body again. And just reconstitute the body with your own stem cells. Okay. So that's sort of a new approach, if the situation allows it. Yes?
So what are they doing?
I think you were starting to ask your question even before I sort of finished that statement. If you can do that, that's what you will do. There's probably a lot of situations where it's just maybe not possible, okay? For whatever medical situation is for that person, okay? Sometimes you don't have the luxury of a couple months, okay? You might be dead from the cancer in a couple months. You don't have time to go through this thing. In the case of my friend, he was still pretty healthy, and they caught this early. It's, you know, just sort of looked into the future, knew it was going to happen, but they had the luxury of time. Okay, so, of course, if you're going to reconstitute, restoring bone marrow function, this is the only cell you need, because that cell will differentiate into all of the others. Okay, there are two general types of lymphoid tissues, primary and secondary. Okay, that's easy to remember, right? Primary and secondary. Let's go to the primary first. Another term for primary lymphoid tissue is a central lymphoid tissue, and that'll have meaning down the road. We're talking about something called central tolerance. That just means tolerance initiated in a central lymphoid tissue or primary lymphoid tissue. The good thing, so what makes a lymphoid tissue a primary?
primary, it is a site of lymphocyte development. If lymphocyte development is happening there, where you have a cell that's not a lymphocyte, and at the end of the development process it is a lymphocyte, that is development, okay? B cells develop in the bone marrow. So the bone marrow is the first primary lymphoid tissue we're gonna talk about. I'm just gonna get introduced, I'm not gonna talk. We're gonna have a whole lecture just on how do you get from a hematopoietic stem cell to a B cell. That's basically a whole lecture. But that process happens in the bone marrow, making the bone marrow a primary lymphoid tissue. Okay? Why do you think they call B cells B cells? Okay? Yeah. Subhash, you sort of went for my sucker joke. Okay? So, yeah, it almost seems too obvious. Well, and actually, B cells weren't discovered in mammals. They were discovered in birds. People were studying chickens. And it's interesting, but in birds, the bone marrow does not make the B cells. This little organ here off of the cloaca, sort of the colon of the bird, that little pouch there, that's where B cell development. So B cells actually were named for the birds. So Christopher wins the, you know, we ate it. You have the right answer there. Okay. I was just like, so B cells develop in the bone marrow, okay? Not the bursa fibrosis, which is the bursa, okay? T cells, the second primary lymphoid tissue is the thymus. There's only two of them, that's interesting, easy to remember. Bone marrow, thymus, okay? Do you think that the cell that turns into a T cell is a resident of the thymus? A T cell is a blood cell. I just got done telling you. All blood cells come from the process of hematopoiesis, which only takes place in the bone marrow. So as you see in this picture, yeah, the terminal stages of T cell development are going to be the thymus, but the journey starts here. With a cell, where in this process do you think is the cell that leaves the bone marrow and says, I'm going to go to the thymus to finish my job? Where do you think it is? Do you think these guys leave? You think that guy leaves? You think that guy leaves? You think that guy leaves? Who leaves? Probably this one right here, right? He says, okay, I took a step down the lymphoid lineage, but I'm not going to be a B cell, so I can't stay here. I'm going to go to the thymus instead. So that arrow is kind of that guy right there. Okay? So he's going to get to that stage of someday I'm going to be a T cell. Okay, I made that decision in the bone marrow, but this isn't the environment for that. That's not the microenvironment. I'm not going to get the cytokines I need. I'm not going to get the cell-cell communication I need. That all happens at the thymus. So we're going to get into the bloodstream, and we're going to home to the thymus, which is right here between our lungs and above our heart. Okay, and that's where I will become a functioning T cell, and then I will leave and go do something for the body. Okay. But the fact that T cell development is happening there makes the thymus a primary lymphoid tissue. Element means primary. Okay? So here's something that you see happening over the time of someone's life, okay, is a process called thymic involution. Okay? Here is a thymus of a 3-day-old infant. That is big, robust, churning out T cells at a rapid rate. Here is a thymus from a 70-year-old adult. Okay? Just sort of remnants. It's like, no, nothing bad happened to it. That's just a natural process. It just sort of withers. Okay? Who do you think is churning out more T cells into their body every day? That 3-year-old or that 70-year-old? Yeah, that is the Dr. Heidler question. Okay? So this is basically what happens to your T cell, to your thymus as we age. Okay? Very active early in our life. That's where we're just churning out T cells. Old age, I mean, there I am. I'm in the 50s group. I mean, you probably couldn't even find one. I'm feeling a new compromise just thinking about it. Okay? So anyway, that's just a natural process, okay? Okay, secondary lymphoid tissues. Primary, secondary. Secondary lymphoid tissues, now, I have to be honest, there are some developmental processes that take place, okay? And for example, what I mean by that, like to go from a B cell to a plasma cell, but we're still B cell, okay? plasma cell is just sort of a different type of B cell. That's going to happen in the secondary lymphoid tissue. That naive T cell becomes an effector T cell. That happens in secondary lymphoid tissue. But what I'm saying is all this other stuff is not happening though, okay? In the secondary tissue. What happens in the secondary tissue is the mature B cells and the mature T cells, that's where they encounter antigen. That's where the immune response happens. Okay? So, when you have a sore throat, okay, if you're anything like I was as a kid, oh, mom, I got a sore throat. My mom would just put her hand up underneath my throat, start poking my throat. What was she feeling for? Lymph nodes. What was she feeling for? Swollen lymph nodes. Why do lymph nodes swell? What physically is getting bigger? I mean, it's just water flushing in there. Ooh, we're filling with water. What is the basis of, whoa, our lymph nodes are getting really big. That's right. Cell division. More cells. Cells start dividing. That's part of the immune response. Something called clonal expansion. The B cells say, hey, I have an antibody to that microbe. Well, there's only one of you. We're going to need thousands of you start dividing. I'm a T cell. I can. This is the microbe that I'm specific for. Well, great. Start dividing. Okay. So that's the immune response. That's the kind of stuff. Secondary lymphoid tissues is where the immune response, the initiation of the immune response happens. Where antigen, that viral protein, that bacterial protein, meets the lymphocytes, the B cells or T cells, the ones that are specific. That might not make sense to you yet, but it will shortly. They undergo clonal expansion. Okay. We're in the fight. We're expanding our numbers. We're going after this thing. Okay. So that's what happens. Okay, so here's our picture of the body, okay? If you were the engineer to design the immune system, where are you gonna put your secondary lymphoid tissues? Your consideration would be, well, where do the microbes come in? Where are they in the body? And I'm gonna put my tissues there, okay? So we have to be able to deal with things that come across the skin. The lymph nodes are gonna do that in ways that I'm gonna show you. Things that come across mucosal surfaces, lymph nodes in many parts of the body are going to deal with that. Okay? Well, sometimes microbes get in the blood. That's what the spleen is going to be for. The spleen filters the blood for antigens. Okay? Well, what about the things that I eat and end up in my small intestine? All those microbes, enteric pathogens. Okay? Well, that's going to be the job of the mucosa associated with the tissue. The biggest, and one we'll be talking about mostly, is a tissue called the Peyer's patches. Okay? So again, there's not a generic way of interacting with the microbe. We inhale them, we eat them, they come across the skin, they're sexually transmitted, they get in our bloodstream. There's going to be ways of dealing with all of those, but different secondary lymphoid tissues are somewhat specialized for certain types of microbial challenges, right? Okay, lymph nodes, what comes across the skin or a tissue. Bloodstream, that's lymph node. What comes across the gut, Peyer's patches, okay? What hits the back of the throat? Tonsils, tonsils are a secondary lymphoid tissue. Okay, so let's go through this. Lymph nodes, okay? They're distributed throughout our body. That's these little yellow things here, okay? Here's the ones in my throat that my mom was always poking for. I got to the point where I stopped telling mom I had a sore throat. I got tired of that. Okay? Anyways, upstream. So here's a lymph node. What kind of cells do you think are in a lymph node? What cell types are in a lymph node? I just told you. Cells? Cells, and for T cell response, you need antigen presenting cells. So, what else is probably there? Dendritic cells and some macrophages, absolutely. So, the types of cells in the secondary lymphoid, it's always the same. It's the cells of the adaptive immune system, B cells, T cells, dendritic cells, macrophages, basically. And they're just sitting there waiting. Where's the antigen? We're bored. We want to do something. We're bored. And when the antigen comes in, that's when all the action starts. Okay? Upstream of a lymph node are lymphatic vessels. If they're upstream, they're called afferent lymphatic vessels, the afferents. Okay? They look like veins and arteries, but there's no heart pumping fluid through there. Okay? Notice that they terminate in these little capillaries. They're open-ended. There's a hole. The fluid or a microbe or a bacterial protein can just go in. Okay? What you need to realize is that fluid from the blood is always leaving the bloodstream, primarily capillary beds, right? What do we have to do with that fluid? If we don't return that fluid to the blood, what happens? Massive edema, swelling. This guy has a disease. He's got elephantiasis. He's infected with a filarial worm that is blocking those lymphatic vessels. The movement of that fluid that has exited the blood and the tissues, primarily the muscles and stuff, is not returning to the bloodstream. It's leaving, but it's not being recycled, and it is staying there in this poor gentleman's legs. Okay? That's just a nice visual of what's happening. But normally, okay, the lymph, that's up, the fluid that leaves the blood, enters the afferents, they filter, they go through a lymph node, because all of the lymph nodes are going to have an afferent supply. If there's any microbe, if you got a tissue infection, this might be right under the skin. Think of a mosquito dropping off a little Zika virus, whoop, into the lymphatic. And it's going to eventually make its way down here. And the B cells and T cells are going to say, hey, is anybody here specific for Zika virus proteins? Oh, you are? Great. Come over here, start dividing. We got something we need to deal with. Okay? So the lymphatics sort of play two functions. One, just that routine housekeeping function, returning fluid to the bloodstream, which I'll explain in a moment. But it's also an antigen collection. Antigen collection for things that come across our skin, exit sort of tissue infections, like, you know, if I have an infection in my muscle or something, there's going to be a lymphatic supply there. Many of the things that come across the mucosal surface, there's lymphatic vessels there that, you know, we came across, and then they're getting drawn into these and find their way in the lymph node. Okay? Exiting the lymph node are the efferent lymphatic vessels. Okay? So what moves the lymph through the lymph supply? If there's no heart pushing it, what's moving it?
Moving
muscle. Okay, look at that. These are one-way valves. These are Fockel valves, right? If I push right there, and I flex my arm, and I flex and I push right there, and there, this is fluid filled. Which way is the fluid going to go? What's going to happen to that valve if I pressurize this chamber? No, it's going to slam shut. It's going to slam shut. Anybody do any plumbing? You know what check valves are? This is a biological check valve. Where you want water to go in one direction, can't back up, here you have a valve that will open and shut based on pressure. So if you pressurize it there, that one shuts, these ones get pushed open. So you move lymph from that chamber to that chamber to that chamber. So when you get in the hospital and you're sitting in your hospital bed, post-op, do they let you sit there for 8 days just watching TV, eating Jell-O? What do? They make you walk. If you can't walk, what do? They'll come in and do range of motion. They'll move your muscles for you. I was a PTA back in the day, and doing range of motion in hospital beds here. Moving your legs, moving your arms, you know, you just do it for them. You move it, because what happens if you sit in bed for 8 days? You start looking like this gentleman. Edema, you start swelling up. So this is a bad thing. Okay, so the efferents, we haven't returned the lymph to the bloodstream yet, right? Efferents all collect into a common duct called the thoracic duct. So this is a plumbing job, right? The little pipes drain into the big pipes, just like your house, right? Little faucets, but if you look what goes out to the sewer, it's a big pipe because it's collecting from all the little ones, okay? Okay? And then the thoracic duct dumps into the left subclavian vein, completing the circuit. We've now gone back into the bloodstream, so we've completed the cycle. So when we left the blood, we collected it, afferents, filtered it through the lymph nodes, see if there's any antigens, efferents, thoracic duct, back into the bloodstream. Okay? I'm going to come back to this, but notice, a lot of these B and T cells are leaving through the efferents. They're leaving. They're going back to the bloodstream. We're going to end the lecture on why that's important. Okay, it's important that you understand how antigens get into the lymph nodes. It's important how you know how lymphocytes get there. Okay, and something very similar happens in the Peyer's patches, which also has this lymph supply and these vessels. I'm going to tell you about in a moment called hydrogenal vessels. Okay, so this is basically what I just described for you, right? Here we have microbes coming across the skin, okay? You think you have complement activation out here? Yeah, just because we're not talking about it anymore, you know that's happening, okay? You think these macrophages are recruiting neutrophils, releasing cytokines and PAP receptor interaction, all that's happening, okay? But some of these antigens, again, if you get an infection, some of them will just find their way, you know, before a neutrophil found them. They're just gonna get into an afferent and they're gonna come down here. There's a dendritic cell, you know, show interacting with T's and B cells and stuff, okay? So antigens get into the lymph node one of two ways. They can just be passively, they're just like a little boat on a little river of lymph. They're just passively getting carried along non-intentionally. Well, I'm just on a river and it ends up in a lymph node, okay? Alternatively, one of the first functions we're going to talk about, dendritic cells. Remember I told you there's a lot of dendritic cells in your skin, a lot of dendritic cells in mucosal surfaces. Here's one right here, okay? Here's a resident cell, okay? He's interactive, okay? And he might be releasing a lot of cytokines, he probably is, but a resident dendritic cell, once they get stimulated by antigen, they say, I don't want to sit in the skin anymore. I'm wasting my time here. I need to actively enter a lymphatic afferent, and I'm going to go down here and show the T cells what I found. Hey guys, look at this. You're not going to believe what I found. Anybody want to react to this? Okay. So that's an active transport of antigens to the lymph node. Okay. Passively or actively through the dendritic cell transport. Macrophages don't do that. Dendritic cells do. So here you see some microbes entering the foot. Here we have a lymph node behind the knee. Once you got activated, look at him go. Okay. This would be called an immature dendritic cell. By the time he gets back here, he will be doing things that this guy wasn't able to do. He'll undergo some differential changes, developmental changes, to be a wonderful APC to the T cells that he finds down here. Okay? So just big conceptual ideas. These are just our big ideas of how this system works. Okay? How do T cells and B cells get into the vessels? Okay? So here, let's start with this picture over here. So here's a lymph node. There's the multiple afferents coming in, a single efferent leaving. Each lymph node is going to have a lymphatic artery bringing blood in, a lymphatic vein having blood go out. Okay? And of course, where arteries and veins meet, these are the capillary beds. Okay? But I want to tell you there's something very specific and special about the capillary beds of lymph nodes, and also in the Peyer's patches, just to be complete about this. Okay? And that is, if you look at the cells that line those vessels, right there, they're expanding that, right? Right there, over here, they're showing it as this right there. And what are those called, those cells that line our blood vessels? Vascular endothelial cells. But these are special ones for this tissue. Okay, what is special about them, okay? Well, the HEV, the hypothalamus, that is the site of entry of B and T cells into the lymph node and into the Peyer's patches, okay? So, here now is the high endothelial. So here's the lymph node, that means on the other, that's out here. Here's the vascular endothelial cells. Here's a circulating B or T cell, okay? And the key here is B and T cells enter the lymph nodes. Neutrophils don't, monocytes don't, red blood cells don't, basophils don't. So what's the difference? When a lymphocyte, a B or T cell, is cruising through the bloodstream, just, here I go, eventually they're going to find this other lymph node, right? It's just a matter of time before the blood takes them there. Why do they say, oh, I'm getting off the boat here and entering this tissue, and other cells just go zipping by? I mean, just what could account for that? They must be receiving some information that the other cells aren't receiving, right? Okay. Well, on their surface, they have receptors for things that are expressed on the HEV. I'm grabbing onto this cell wall. You guys didn't have this receptor. You guys were just flying. You're out of lymph node already. I stuck here because I had an affinity. Okay. Look at this picture right here. This is an electron micrograph. Here's the high endothelial venules, that little tube. What are all these guys? Those are Bs and T cells stuck to the HEV walls through these cell-cell interactions. What do you think that green molecule is going to do? This green molecule was produced by the lymph node inside here. Okay, there it is on the apical surface. What do chemokines do? They attract. Do you think neutrophils have a chemokine receptor for this guy? Well, I just told you they're not attracted in. Okay. Do you think monocytes do? No. Do you think B cells do? Yes. Do you think T cells do? Yes. So this is just B and T cells have receptors for things that those other cells don't. And when they get into the HEV, they stick, and then they dive in. They're going to follow those chemokines. Chemokines are going to draw them in. Okay? So that's how they get in. How do B and T cells leave a lymph node? You think they just go the other way and jump into the bloodstream through the HEV going diabetes into the bloodstream? You can just look at that picture up there and see it, or you can use this picture that I showed you. Well, it's shown in this picture. It's shown in that picture. They go out the efferents. The efferents is the exit, right? The efferents are the exit of a lymph node. So they come in through the blood, they exit through the efferents. And where is the efferents going to take them eventually? Back to the blood. So this is called lymphocyte circulation, lymphocyte surveillance. They're cruising through the body, through the bloodstream, entering these tissues. tuned for, okay? Here's the HEV, okay? The hyalothelial venules, or the endothelial cells, are sort of the tan-colored ones. Here's the lymphocytes that are bound, and now they're diapedesing in, okay? So you see the importance of cell-cell communication. And huge cell-cell contacts, you know, cytokines, chemokines, things to influence cellular behavior. Okay, let's go to the spleen. Remember, the big theme of what we're talking about right now is what? So here are the four tissues. We just covered the lymph nodes. Let's go to the next one, okay? Spleen, there's the spleen. Also has a blood supply. Spleen, the artery brings blood in. Spleen vein exits the blood, okay? In general, you're gonna learn a lot more about this in medical school, but in general, the spleen does two things. There's two parts, red pulp and white pulp. What does the red pulp do? The red pulp is basically where sort of quality control on red blood cells is involved. Hey, here's some damaged red blood cells, here's some old ones, let's get rid of them. Let's just get rid of them, pull them out of the body, okay? The white pulp is the immune functioning part of the spleen. What types of cells do you think you find in the white pulp?
Leukocytes?
Well, there will be leukocytes there. Is that because of the white part? That makes sense. Okay, but no, think a little deeper. I just told you that there's exact same cells in all the secondary liver tissues. It's the site of lymphocyte activation with antigen. So you're going to expect, just like in the lymph node, what are you going to find in the white pulp? B cells, T cells, macrophages, dendritic cells. Okay? The exact same process is happening in the spleen as in the lymph node, as in the tonsils, as in the appendix, as in the thyroid patches. It's all the same cells, they're just in different parts of the body dealing with different types of invasions. Okay? Do you think that the spleen can respond very well to antigens in the lymph? Yes or no? Why not? There's no afferents. There's no lymph supply. There's no, look at the picture. There's no afferents and efferents. Lymph does not go to the spleen. That's the job of the lymph node. So no, the spleen, you know, what is the real value of the spleen is it allows you to make immune responses to microbes get in your blood. What is virus in the blood called? Viremia. What is bacteria in the blood called? Septicemia, bacteremia, okay? So sometimes you get microbes in your blood. You better have a spleen to deal with it. Because did antigens get into the lymph node out of the blood? No, we never talked about antigens jumping across the HEV, right? So no, the lymph nodes do not monitor antigen in the blood. That is your spleen's job. Okay? Just big ideas here. And you can have a whole lecture on the microanatomy of the spleen. That's not the medical school will teach you that. That's not the point. Okay? Here's a question. I would focus on the term minor break. I didn't say massive wound. A little break in the skin, say. All right, three of you. Two of you, and we will call it. Here we go. What did we do here? All right. Like I said, I was going to go that was okay. So obviously the microbe did make its way into the blood, got under the skin, found its way into the afferent lymph nodes. You expect that you find secondary liquid tissues associated with the gut. In fact, at any given moment of your life, more lymphocytes are down in your Peyer's pattern, in your small intestines, than anywhere else. Your spleen is really sort of the largest organ, but most of the lymphocytes will be down in your gut. What does that imply? I mean, evolution decided that this is how it should be. Your cells are always moving. Where are most of them right now? Most of them are down in your gut. That, again, evolution, things are packaged sterile food and water bottles and stuff. Like, no, come on, man. That's a little blip in human evolution. We're out there drinking out of the ponds and scrounging for whatever we can find, just like a coyote or a hyena, right? I mean, we don't are exposed to the microbes that we're used to, but our bodies, that evolution shaped it based on those pressures, not modern day pressures, okay? So yeah, maybe nowadays we don't ingest and drink a bunch of contaminated stuff, but historically we have, right? So yeah, that's where a lot of lymphocytes are, because that's where the invasion typically comes from, okay? So again, the tonsils, that's associated with mucosal surface right at the back of your throat. Right as you eat something, you have the way of sampling, okay? Is there any virus or bacteria in this, okay? We're gonna have a whole lecture on mucosal immunity, okay? Mucosal immunology. So I'm gonna save the detail, nitty-gritty details for that lecture, okay? Let's jump down into the papyrus patches, okay? So here's in the small intestine, okay? So this is what most of the small intestine is, just these are called enterocytes, little microvilli enterocytes that are doing what? Absorbing nutrients, regulating, you know, fluid outflow, fluid intake, okay? But you get to these regions, here's a cross-section through a mouse small intestine. Here's the absorptive part of the small intestine. These big assemblages they call PP, those are the papyrus patch. Here is a papyrus patch, okay? Here are papyrus patches underneath here, okay? Why do we call them papyrus patches? Discovered by Dr. Papyrus, no doubt. Okay? I'm guessing. I'm assuming that's what it was. Because first P is capitalized, so I think this is someone's name, okay? But basically, these cells here are set up to decide, is there any dangerous non-cell came in with this pond water I just sucked down? Or out of this nice, tasty bone that I just found and were chewing on, okay? What kind of cells do you find then?
T cells.
All together now.
B cells.
Yeah, right? It's the same cell. You have the same response, we're just having a challenge in a different way, okay? I'm going to talk a lot more about this. So notice here we have the afferents, efferents and stuff. This M cell is very important. Because some of you might say, well, how does the antigens actually get in there? It looks like, you know, the antigens are out here in your gut. How do they get into these B cells and T cells? Well, there's multiple. I mean, sometimes it's maybe just the infection. You just breach the mucosa, and boom, there they are. But the M cell plays a major role in transport of antigens, so we'll just save that for a later day. Okay, the last concept, here's papyrus patches. Okay? Here's an endoscopy looking through the small intestine. These arrows are pointing to papyrus patches. I mean, these things are big. Look, they're pushing into the small intestine. I mean, these are big assemblages of lymphocytes and dendritic cells. On the right-hand side there, that's the small intestine of someone who's been infected with HIV for 3 weeks. Literally only 3 weeks. The whole architecture. Do you think there's a lot of T cells in the papyrus patches? Absolutely. And here the HIV's destroyed them. Where are they? There's probably little remnants of them, but they're certainly not these big bulging things that you'd like to see in a healthy small intestine. Okay. Here's the tonsils. Okay. And here's the last big idea. So we've already talked about lymphocytes moving, right? Coming from the blood, binding to the high endothelial venules, getting into a lymph node, exiting through the efferents, into the thoracic duct, back in the bloodstream. Okay. Unlike any other organ system of your body where the cells are static, how many of your liver cells cruise around your body? How many of your muscle cells or your neurons just, oh yeah, I'm going to go and I don't like the brain anymore. I'm going to go down and innervate the toe. Right? It doesn't happen, right? It doesn't happen. The lymphoid system is you might have, there's a lymph node, there's a spleen, there's a papyrus patch. The structure remains, but the cellular constituents are constantly turning over. Cells coming, cells going. Cells coming, cells going. This is called lymphocyte circulation. But what I really want you to think about is immune surveillance. What are those B cells and T cells doing? Why are they moving? I mean, fundamentally, why are they moving? What is the job description of a lymphocyte? Find antigen and respond. Okay, that's what they got to do. And they're the papyrus patches. No, let's get to that. So here's a, you're going to learn that lymphocytes are antigen specific. So there's going to be a B cell. I'm going to reach into my body and pull out a B cell with an antibody on the surface. And look at that antibody and say, you know, the only thing you're good for is that antibody binds to polioprotein. That's the only thing you're good for. You're worthless against any other microbe because you can only respond to polioprotein. Do I want that cell sitting in the lymph node under my arm? So right now I have a B cell in my Peyer's patch. In 20 minutes, it might be in my bloodstream. 20 other minutes, it might be in a lymph node under my arm. Then it's in my bloodstream. Then it's in another lymph node. Then it's in the efferent, going through my tonsils. They're surveying, okay? Last question and we'll turn you loose. I apologize, I think it's about 1 minute over. So since we don't meet again today, based on the progress I make today on rewriting that lecture, maybe tomorrow, I will email you all and let you know what exam schedule we're going to be on, okay? All right, you're all done. How did we do? Okay, so true or false, a mature T lymphocyte that's circulating through the body, you know, cruising through all autoimmune tissues, will likely spend more time circulating through the thymus than it will spend circulating through the Peyer's patches, and survey says you think that is false. Why is that false?
There are more lymphocytes in the Peyer's patches than anywhere else in the body.
Well, again, what you said there's more what there? Holly, what did you say? There's more what in the Peyer's patches?
Lymphocytes.
Okay, no, I don't think that's the answer though. You got the right answer for maybe the wrong rationale. I mean, this isn't a, I'm just asking you a matter of just, if you're going to go someplace, where are you going to spend most of your time? You're right, most of them are in the Peyer's patch, but like on a time basis, okay? All those guys are going to leave. Does it make anybody else want to say why they say false? And this isn't the size of the organ issue. That doesn't get you to the answer in my mind.
Isn't it because mature and thymus when they develop the Peyer's secondary?
So when they're circulating, what did I say they're looking for? They're looking for antigen. Is the thymus a secondary lymphoid tissue where antigens come in and the immune response is happening? Now, once a T cell leaves the thymus, can any of you think of a single reason why it would make evolutionary sense for it to ever go back there? You know, that's where it developed. It needs to spend the rest of its life looking for antigen. That's the job of the secondary lymphoid tissue, which upwards of higher fat. So you have to think of why are we doing surveillance? There's certain reasons, there would be no reason.